we moved in the little flitting circle of light shed by the lantern. All around us and above us was a horrible, voiceless darkness, held, as it were, at bay by the friendly light. "If I could only overtake him once," moaned Josie, "if I could just kiss him once and hold him close against my aching heart. This pain that never leaves me would leave me then. Oh, my pretty boy, wait for mother. I am coming to you. Listen, David, he cries. He cries so pitifully. Listen, can't you hear it?" I did hear it. Clear and distinct, out of the deadly still darkness before us, came a faint, wailing cry. What was it? Was I too going mad, or was there something out there? Something that cried and moaned, longing for human love, yet ever retreating from human footsteps. I am not a superstitious man, but my nerve had been shaken by my long trial, and I was weaker than I thought. Terror took possession of me, terror unnameable. I trembled in every limb, clammy perspiration oozed from my forehead. I was possessed by a wild impulse to turn and flee, anywhere away from that unearthly cry. But Josephine's cold hand gripped mine firmly and led me on. The strange cry still rang in my ears. But it did not recede. It sounded clearer and stronger. It was a wail, but a loud, insistent wail. It was nearer, nearer. It was in the darkness just beyond us. Then we came to it. A little dory had been beached on the pebbles and left there by the receding tide. There was a child in it, a boy of perhaps 2 years old, who crouched in the bottom of the dory in water to his waist, his big blue eyes wild and wide with terror, his face white and tear-stained. He wailed again when he saw us and held out his little hands.